Welcome back, everyone. Today we are taking a look at Lee Krasner, a 20th century American painter known for talent, knowledge, and innovation. If you're new, make sure to subscribe for more art-related content. First, I'll give an overview of her life before examining some of her artworks.
And she says, painting is not separate from life, it is one. It's like asking, do I want to live? And my answer is yes, and so I paint.
Born in Brooklyn on October 27th, 1908, Lee was the daughter of Russian refugees. She would study art at the Woman's College within the Cooper Union and at the National Academy of Design before working and studying with the likes of Hans Hofmann and Piet Mondrian. Her connections and education led her to be extremely knowledgeable in all facets of the art world, which many of her contemporaries also knew.
Well, I had certainly seen paintings of the Cubist masters like Picasso, Mondrian, Matisse, before I became a Hofmann student, but specifically what Hofmann was teaching were the principles of Cubism.
Despite this, most people only know her for her marriage to the famous artist Jackson Pollock. The two were together for around 2 decades, with Lee's knowledge and guidance helping Jackson find his iconic style. Pollock's rise to fame caused the public to overlook Lee's talent for her husband's, which is why most people unfortunately don't recognize her name. Lee found positives in this though, saying it gave her more freedom creatively, as there weren't millions of eyes watching her every brushstroke. Being the educated woman she was, Lee used the public image of her to her advantage, alongside her immense networking skills. Additionally, she was able to create magnificent pieces in a range of styles and mediums, which we will look at later. It shows her knowledge and adaptability. Her passing in June of 1984 came after a retrospective of her work from the 60s opened at MoMA. Fortunately, it was also displayed in Texas near her home at the time, as her arthritis was too serious for a trip to New York City. Now, the house which Lee lived in with Pollock is a public museum, with remnants in the form of paint splatters and the like decorating the space.
The first director, Meg Perlman, and she saw that there was all this color and gesture all over the floor, so she had conservators come in.
Their home can be described as akin to the modern cottagecore aesthetic trend, and the two would create art in all areas of the home. Family members of Lee said that the one area which was off limits was her designated studio space. Family members needed an invitation to enter the room. If you go in there now, you can see the walls covered in different paints. When she painted, she hung the canvas on the wall and did it that way, and that was the only way she would paint. Before we take a look at her artworks, we should become familiar with her creative process.
You just take a deep breath and hope for the best and get into it.
As a part of the abstract expressionist movement, her works focus more so on the gestural aspects of creating large visual media, along with medium to small, but she's most well known for her huge mural paintings. It is the lunging across the canvas, the flinging of the paint, stretching and circling your arms to make these abstract visuals that's important for these works. Sometimes referred to as heroic gestures, these movements are utilized by Krasner in her process. In many ways, she went with the flow, not locking in a final image in her head for the piece that she was working on, as she describes in this interview.
Change it. I don't say it's got to be blue. And I insist on letting it go the way it's going to go rather than forcing it.
The thing is alive and going, and that, you know, gets me all my adrenaline going, and then I want to stay with it. I pretty much know by now. And when it's a dead duck, I know that too.
She did have some rules though. These include that she did not like working on canvases much taller than her, as she always mounted them on the wall before making markings. Since she was just 5 and a half feet tall, or around 163 to 165 centimeters, this created one of the characterizations of her artworks. One of her most recognized eras was the umber painting phase of her life. Preceded by Jackson Pollock's death It was an emotionally charged period for Krasner. Leading up to his death, their relationship was rocky, to put it lightly. What made this even more complicated was how his passing put an end to his career, overshadowing hers.
His studio space, it must have been a very loaded space emotionally, but she's very practical. It's the largest space, it has the best natural light, mm-hmm. and suddenly it allows her to take unstretched canvas, to tack it to the wall, and to make paintings that are 15 feet in length, which she has never done before. The Umber series really occurs at the peak of this moment of her discovery.
Partially. Psychological chaos can be seen in the brash movements necessary to create these Umber paintings. Seated from 1960 exemplifies this. Signature to this distraught series are the muted tones and limited palette of browns. Her choice in this exclusiveness was a result of her creating these at night, as she had developed insomnia and needed a way to pass her time. Early on in her career, though, she adopted the practice of exclusively using natural sunlight in order to light the space, such as her studio, while she was painting. And since the Umber paintings were created at night under artificial light, she could not use any bright or vibrant colors like she usually did. Aggressive and cyclical heroic gestures cover the canvas, but big and small. The entirety is consumed by this muddy explosion, like how her life was forever changed by the death of her husband in 1956.
Look at her work, because it's essentially a diary of what was happening. This was a moment when Lee had to reckon with who she was post-Pollock.
By the late 60s, Krasner had moved on, entering a new artistic era. Unlike the previous period, she now used a bright color palette, and she began to make many changes to her creative process. Primary series, these colorful paintings emphasize saturated tones, as seen in Portrait in Green, created in 1969. This was an era where she allowed her painting process to be documented for the first time by photographer Paddocky. This is groundbreaking because she wouldn't even let her closest family members into her studio without permission. So letting someone take pictures of her and letting those pictures be shared and spread around was a large change in her mindset and her process. Another one of her recognizable works called Untitled, and it was painted in 1949. Inspired by the Hebrew she studied growing up, this painting seems to have an oscillating repetition without an explicit pattern. It's small with a loose grid structure, similar to an illuminated manuscript. About 3 feet in height, this painting is part of a collection of works she made by applying paint in numerous thick layers. Unlike her later works, this one was placed flat on a table while created the image. Krasner's previous technique of painting in this way allowed for more controlled expressions, like walking a dog on a very short leash. I think it's interesting to see how her approach changed so much over the decades, while still having a signature feel to them and remaining in the abstract expressionist movement. I only took a look at a few of her works, but if she piqued your interest, please explore Krasner's portfolio. She had a massive impact on the abstract expressionist movement and is an important artist for understanding the art of the 20th century and women's roles in contemporary art. If you enjoyed this video, make sure to like and subscribe for more content from me. And if you haven't already, go watch my previous Artists You Should Know videos on Mariko Mori and Albert Namatjira. I will see you soon, and have a great day.